ग्रेस,
So, a very good evening and warm welcome from Sanofi to our respected doctors who are esteemed speakers today, and to all the medical fraternity who have joined us today for this webinar. So I'm Grace Sam, working in Medical Affairs Associate for Sanofi CHC. So this webinar is conducted in association with IORG and Ortho TV. So today, we have yet another very interesting topic, which is implant selection and wearing options in THR and the intraoperative and postoperative complications in THA. So we have two of our most eminent speakers with us here today. Dr. Gahir, we welcome you, and Dr. Subhash Shange, we welcome you, sir. So before we go into the agenda and I take you through it, we will just see a video, a 1 minute video on one of our very new brands, which is Colafix Pro Plus, which is a combination of UC2, Mobili, and curcumin.
In severe osteoarthritis, life of a patient halts, and their search for pain relief and improving joint health never stops. Conventional therapy fails to address the patient's triple concerns of osteoarthritis. Let us address their triple concerns of osteoarthritis with a triple action formula, a combination of UC2, Mobili, and curcumin for the triple concerns of osteoarthritis. UC2 is a patented, undenatured type 2 collagen made in USA through a low temperature non-enzymatic process by Lonza. UC2 protects cartilage through novel mechanism of oral tolerance. Mobili is a patented and natural super sodium hyaluronate from Bio Iberica. Mobili helps in relieving pain with its analgesic action. Curcumin is a natural and time-tested anti-inflammatory. Curcumin reduces inflammation with its anti-inflammatory action. It's time to get your patients back on track with a powerful right dose combination. Sanofi proudly introduces for the first time in India a powerful right dose combination, Colaflex Pro Plus. Consists two patented and all natural ingredients. Colaflex Pro Plus, ensuring joint health, delivering pain relief with its triple action formula.
Yes. Thank you all for that patient hearing. So, without much ado, we will go into the session. So as you all know, there are a lot of factors which affect a perfect THR or THA. And today we have this topic of implant selection and bearing options in THR, which our eminent speaker, Dr. Rajendra Singh Gahir, will take you through in another 20 minutes. And then we will have a session from our esteemed speaker, Dr. Subhash Jangir, on the complications associated in the postoperative THA. And after this, we will also address your questions and our eminent speakers will give you answers for your queries. So before we go into this session, I would like to introduce you all to Dr. Rajendra Singh Gahir. So Dr. Gahir is an MBBS, MS and MRCS Edinburgh, and he has also done his FRCS in trauma and ortho. So Dr. Gahir has graduated from Calcutta Medical College, and he has also completed his MS in orthopedics from the same institute. He was also trained at various centers of excellence in UK, and he worked with the National Health Service, NHS UK, for almost 12 years. He did his fellowship at the Golden Jubilee National Hospital in Glasgow, and he has been extensively trained in hip and knee replacements, including revision arthroplasty. So after that, doctor has relocated to Calcutta in 2015 and has been practicing as an independent practitioner in Kolkata since Jan 2015. So doctor also has a lot of publications to his credit in a lot of national and international journals and abstracts as well. Doctor has also taken part in a lot of audits in surgery. He has also done various presentations in national and international conferences. So doctor has also been a recipient of many awards and distinctions. He has got the Best Paper Award at the State Annual Orthopedic Conference in 2001. He has been a topper at the university for his MS orthopedic exam. And he has also a Certificate of Merit in Community Medicine. So he has also been a reviewer of many articles submitted for the American Journal of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation and the Orthopedics Journals and the Journal of Hand and Microsurgery. Doctor has also been in the editorial board member of the UKITE 2012 UK in training. Doctor has also attended various arthroplasty trainings throughout his entire career. He has also some management experience to his credit. Doctor has also taken the Train the Trainer course in Glasgow in 2011. So we are very grateful, Doctor, to have you here today. And thank you for accepting our invitation and being here with us. So we are waiting to go into the session. Over to you, Doctor. Doctor, you're muted.
Thank you, Grace. Let us kickstart the presentation. And right, okay. So we will talk about selection of implants and bearing surfaces in total hip arthroplasty. And the goals of a total hip arthroplasty, you know, we as orthopedic surgeons know that when a patient gets a painless mobile joint where there is no limb length discrepancy and on the X-ray you've got a perfect anatomical hip center, and of course from the patient's point of view, he has a hip which will last for the rest of the patient's life. So that's the rehabilitation from the surgery. And we will talk about the hip implant selection today. Now, we've got a wide array of options in front of us. And, you know, as a new consultant, when you start doing hip arthroplasty, then it's rather confusing about which one to choose and what is the logic behind choosing a particular implant. So let us just divide them into two very simple concepts. So we talk about implant and we talk about bearing options. So from implant point of view, we have the implant on the acetabulum side and the implant on the stem side. And then we have you know, various ways of fixing the implant. And from the bearing options point of view, we have the classical hard and soft bearing, where we have the metal head, which is cobalt chrome, which is bearing with a polyethylene cup in the acetabulum. And thereafter, we have progressed to ceramic head articulating with the polyethylene cup. And then we have the option of a hard-on-hard bearing, which is a ceramic head with a ceramic liner, and of course, the metal-on-metal, about which we'll discuss later on. So the implant selection considerations depend a lot about the patient's bone quality, the morphologic features of the bone, the way the surgeon decides to fix the implant, and of course, the design of the joint articulation. So that's where the knowledge about tribology and the various features of different implants come into place. And the wear of the joint bearing surface sort of determines the overall survival of the implant. And last but not the least, you know, practicing in a very price-sensitive market, the implant cost is also one of the considerations. So let us first start with the bone quality. Now, we know that bone quality decreases as age increases, and the features of clinical osteoporosis and radiographic osteopenia increases with age and medical disease. And we have these markers which can be used to determine the amount of osteopenia and osteoporosis in the bone, the Singh index and the femoral index, which measure the bone density, and they show decreasing bone quality with age. So the general perception is for elderly patients with poor bone stock, we use a cemented hip implants. And for younger patients with good bone stock, we use a cementless implant. Now that's a very blanket statement, but then that's the overall general perception. Let us delve into details. Morphologic features of the bone. Now, if we look properly at a hip X-ray, a degenerate hip X-ray, then one thing which becomes quite noteworthy is that the proximal femur is quite variable in the shape and in the morphologic features. Whereas On the pelvic side, it is generally possible to create a hemispheric acetabular bed and then implant the acetabular cup into the bed. And for a determination of the femoral morphologic features, we have the door types, which are dependent on the thickness of the cortex, then the canal to calcar isthmus ratio, and the osteoblastic cellular activity in the proximal part of the femur. And Dorr described three different types of shapes of the femur. So type A was a funnel shaped, which had very good thick cortices with active angiogenesis, osteogenesis going on. And type C is a stovepipe shaped proximal femur with very thin cortices and limited osteogenic cellular activity. And type B is in between the two. Next comes implant fixation. So the successful implant fixation in a hip replacement requires very precise, accurate surgical technique. So irrespective of the implants we use, it is the surgical technique which is the most important part of determining the overall outcome of the hip replacement. And that's where training and being conversant with a particular implant comes into picture. And the basic principles of implant fixation is either a cemented implant or an uncemented implant. So for cemented implants, we start with the acetabulum. Very simple principles, one after the other. When you're doing a hip replacement, the first thing you do is a good exposure of the hip joint, expose the acetabulum, a 360 degree exposure, and then a hemispheric reaming to the cortiloid notch, forming multiple peripheral 2 to 3 millimeter holes for cement intrusion, and then large anchor holes in the three parts of the pelvis, and then pulsatile irrigation followed by drying the bone surface, and then pressurizing the bone cement, and then finally implanting the cement, implanting the cup in the cement mantle, and of course removal of the excess cement. The same principle holds true for femoral fixation as well. You know, proper preparing of the femoral canal, insertion of the cement plug, pulsatile lavage, and then implantation of the femoral stem. Now we have moved on to the third generation cementation techniques in femoral stems. And next, coming to the cementless hip fixation, the cementless fixation of hip implant depends on the geometry of the hip implant, and the initial stability depends on the way it is fixed, the press fit of the implant, and then the long-term positioning depends on the bony ingrowth or ongrowth to a porous surface. And of course, surgical technique is the most important part of the cementless hip arthroplasty. So initial, as I said, initial implant stability is provided by the implant design and the technique of implantation, and the long-term fixation is provided by bony and fibrous ingrowth or ongrowth. And the surgical technique is very important, and the implant must be positioned to maximum stability in the bone and maximize the contact area of the porous surface with the host bone. Coming to the cementless acetabular fixation. So if you look at most of the clinically successful cementless acetabular cups, they have a hemispheric shape and they have a rough or porous surface. And when we ream the acetabular cup, it is under-reamed by 1 to 2 millimeter to enhance the initial press fit fixation. And then ultimate fixation occurs later on by on-growth or ingrowth. Looking at the stems for cementless stem fixation, they have been divided by, they've been classified by Mont in 2011 into six different types. Now, type one is a single wedge stem. So it is the commonly used accolade or taper lock, where the wedge is in one plane. And then type two is a double wedge. It is, we've seen this in Synergy and Summit type of stems. And type three are the tapered stems, which are tapered round as in Mallory Head stems, or a tapered cone as in Wagner stem, and the tapered rectangle in the Zimmerlid or the CLS stems. Type four are the extensively coated AML stems, which have progressed onto solution or long stems for appropriate use. And type five are the modular ones, which have got separate diaphyseal and metaphyseal components. And type six is the anatomical stem, which has got a curved proximal and distal parts, both laterally and posteriorly. But then they have not yielded good satisfactory clinical results, so they're not much in use now. Looking at the cost of implants overall, in a single statement, we could say that the cementless hip implants are more expensive than the cemented ones. But then there have been lots of studies which determine the apart from the actual cost of the implant, which determines the overall usage of other paraphernalia during the surgery, and there's not much of a difference in cost when there is a standardized rate for the implants. And then we have got certain special circumstances like growth disturbance, where various sort of special stems come into picture, and these gradually, you know, you would get conversant with these in later on in your training, and as you become more conversant with doing the arthroplasty. And then sometimes we have this protrusio type of fixture where cages come into place. And also, you know, if there's a previous implants, then again, there's a question of using sort of customized or various types of other implants in place. Now, let us move on to the bearing options. So as I said earlier, hard on soft or hard on hard. Now, if we look at this 56-year-old school teacher with a controlled diabetes whose mobility is restricted. So severe degenerative changes, a standard metal on polyarthroplasty. Now, I just want to focus on the bearing surface rather than the implant fixation modes. So poly on metal on poly, and the center of the metal head is equidistant from the margins of the cup. And that's the initial picture. And then over time, as the implant wears, loosens, and the head gradually goes into an eccentric position, so there is more wear on the superolateral weight-bearing zone. And that progressive loss of wearing substance is known as wear, which causes osteolysis. And we know the types of wear. The type one is the adhesive wear, type two is the abrasive, and then the third body wear and the fatigue wear. And there are various modes in which wears occur. Mode one is where it's between two primary bearing surface, and mode two is between primary and the secondary bearing surface. And mode three is between two primary bearing surface where there is an interposed third body particle. And mode four is between two non-bearing surfaces rubbing together. So with the concerns about wear came up the highly cross-linked ultra-high molecular weight polyethylene. And it was seen that cross-linking of polyethylene by gamma irradiation improves the resistance to wear. So there was found to be 70% reduction in total penetration of the ultra-high molecular weight polyethylene. So if we look at this randomized study in the Journal of Arthroplasty, the rate of osteolysis with the traditional polyethylene, which was about 22%, reduced to less than 0.1% in the cross-linked polyethylene, and the survivorship was quite good. And if we next move on to a young patient with an idiopathic AVN, where there's a progressive loss of hip range of movements and features of florid AVN. So in this case, we have a bearing surface of ceramic on poly. And ceramic on poly is now the sort of more preferred choice in younger patients. And of course, we also have the ceramic on ceramic. So ceramics are alumina zirconia combinations. They increase the toughness of alumina. And this is the composition, 75% of alumina with 24% zirconia and 1% chromium oxide. And the evidence on ceramic on ceramic, is it more resistant to wear? So if you look at the mean total wear at 5 years with a traditional polyethylene, it was close to a millimeter. Cross-linked poly reduced it to about 0.33. And with the ceramic, it is less than 0.03. So ceramic on ceramic is the only bearing that has long-term survival without adverse reaction to wear debris. So the concern with wear leading to aseptic loosening of the implant was gradually countered with the advent of ceramic. But then, of course, every good thing comes with a catch. So a unique complication of ceramic is a linear fracture. With the old ceramics, it was quite common, ranging to about 20%, whereas with the new ones, it is now less than 0.1%. About 1 to 20% of patients complain of squeaking or when the ceramic on ceramic head moves. And then this sort of over time sort of settles into a more stable position. And if there's less chance to customize ceramic on ceramic because there's only one head size per cup diameters. And of course, there are difficulties during revision of ceramic. Now, let us look at this picture, which is going back about a century ago, a 40-year-old young postman with secondary degenerative changes. We know his work involves a lot of movements, a lot of activities, and he's got severe degenerative changes in the hip. So in 2007, this was the preferred mode of treatment for such a patient, a metal on metal resurfacing arthroplasty. Now, over the years, we've seen metal and metal resurfacing arthroplasty go up and then come down at the same rate. So let us look at the benefits of metal on metal. It has got a very high wear resistant and it favors large diameters. You know, we prefer large diameters in younger patients. So metal on metal favors large diameters. And the wear rate is about 2% of the wear rate of the ultra high molecular weight polyethylene. And sort of theoretically, it should last a lifeline. Now, the risks of metal on metal, there is an increased iron levels about 5 to 10 times in the blood. So childbearing age women should not have a metal on metal. And there have been delayed type of hypersensitivity reactions called the alveal or the pseudotumor lesions, which have been seen in the metal-on-metal arthroplasties. And there have been concerns about carcinogenesis, but nothing substantial has come on yet. Now, if we look at the registries which do high-volume recording of their cases, Australian registry first reported increased revision rates in 2008. So that's when the metal-on-metal was at its peak. And then the UK registry 2 years later showed an increased revision rates with this metal-on-metal. And if you look at the combined registry data in 2011, there was an increased rate of revision for large femoral head metal-on-metal prostheses compared with other bearing surfaces. So the risk of revision was very high with the particular implant, the ASR, and which was later on recalled. The Birmingham hip resurfacing again had a revision rate close to 5%, and the Cormet had about 7%. So over time, the risk of revision was seen to be very high with metal on metal. So if you look at the traditional metal on poly or ceramic on ceramic, they have a very low risk of revision, but metal on metal had a very high risk of revision. And this was the peak, and this landmark paper from Lancet was the final nail for metal on metals, which showed sort of decreasing usage over time. So by 2011, we had come back to where we had started in 2003 and 4. And the Journal of Arthroplasty in 2010 in its editorial said the lack of clinical advantage and the significant downsides to the use of metal on metal means that this bearing option should be used with great caution, if at all. And this is the hip articulation trend. If you look at metal on poly, it has maintained itself over the years and it has gradually increased over time as well. The ceramic on poly, initial uprise, and then it has now reduced down to sort of very low levels. And ceramic on ceramic has gradually maintained itself after its initial surge in 2007-8. So to summarize, cemented hips generally are preferred in elderly osteoporotic patients, and they are, from the cost point of view, they are comparatively cheaper compared to the uncemented implants. And uncemented implants are preferred in young patients who have very strong bone. And of course, they are expensive compared to the cemented implants. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you so much for taking us through that session, for showing us all the intricate details about implant selection and bearings. I think it was it would have been very useful for our orthopedicians and surgeons. So without much delay, I would like to go into our next session. So before that, I would like to just remind all of you. So if you have any queries, please put it in the Q&A tab at the bottom of your panel, and your queries will be addressed by our experts. So, yes, so before we go into the next session about the complications, I would like you all to like to introduce you all to our speaker, Dr. Subhash Jangi. So, doctor is currently working as the director and head of orthopedics and joint reconstruction at Fortis Memorial Research Institute, Gurgaon. Doctor has his primary work comprises of knee, hip, shoulder joint related surgeries, including replacement. Doctor has a vast experience of more than 19 years and more than 10,000 surgeries in the field of orthopedics. He is a very well-known faculty in the field of arthroplasty or joint replacement in India and abroad. He's also a faculty for various AO trauma courses. Doctor is also the first surgeon in India who has used the computer navigation technique, NAV technique, in the joint replacement. Doctor is also trained in partial knee replacement surgery. So doctor has also introduced the NAVIO robot technique for knee replacement surgeries at FMRI Gurgaon. So doctor has completed his post-graduation from the prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. He is currently performing approximately 500 joint replacement surgeries every year, and is also actively involved in research and academics with many multinational surgical companies. So again, we are very privileged to have you here, doctor, today with us. Thank you for accepting our invitation, and thank you for helping us in spreading education. So over to you, doctor, for your session.
Thank you, Grace, for an elaborative introduction. And after the talk of Dr. Gahir, now we are moving towards the complication. And one of the thing which my mentor used to tell me is that the implant never fails. It's the surgeon who fails.
Absolutely.
So we as a surgeon have to be very, very careful while putting any implant which comes in the market, like the metal on metal, which came risen to a very high levels. I did a lot of them, but ultimately I had to revise plenty of my own surgeries, and which you don't like. The surgeon never likes to revise their own case, and that's the and that's where you have to reach, that you don't want to see your own complications. And so I'd like to go ahead with the so when you talk about the hip replacement part, so it's a very highly effective procedure, and that is why it has been like done right, left and center, and we have definitely increased our indications as well. And because of the gratifying results patient experience, this surgery has become the victim of its own success. Why? Because once you see that the surgery has been successful, and then plenty of patients, they keep on coming to you and realize that, okay, I can do the surgery, I can give the better results. And then this, we start abusing the surgery, and that's where we start getting more and more complications. So it has practically become a victim of its own success. And every surgery has certain general complications. We'll not go into detail of them. They are like the any UTI or the respiratory infections or pulmonary issues, atelectasis, or and bowel problems, or a thromboembolic complication. So that's not part of our today's talk. We have to focus on the procedure specific complications. So a lot of them, hemorrhage, nerve injury, pericardial fractures, we'll go through them one by one, and we'll try to assess what is the correct modality to diagnose them and how to manage them. So if you talk about the hemorrhage, so bleeding is one part where the surgeon usually disagrees. So it varies between the clinicians and centers. Some surgeons, they are not very careful and their bleeding is on a higher side. Some centers also work that way. So plenty of you see our seniors, they used to arrange 1 or 2 units of blood for the hip replacement surgery, minimum 2 units. If I consider my PG days, my HOD usually give minimum arrange 2 units blood for any hip replacement surgery. And currently in our scenario, if the hemoglobin is around 12, we probably don't arrange a blood for ourselves. So bleeding is, if the surgeon think that this is beyond a range of a typical expected level, that means the bleeding is on a higher side, or if it leads to a prolonged stay in the hospital. You need to be very, very careful, especially when you are cutting the capsule of the hip joint and when you're reaming the acetabulum. And you're putting the screw inside, if you hit the internal leg artery or vein, the patient is going to die on table. So there's no point of any torrential hemorrhage you will see on the surgical site if you're careful and if you're good in your soft tissue handling. So when we arrange the blood for pre-op period, so if the patient pre-op HB is on the lower side, the patient is an elderly patient, females tend to bleed slightly more. Also, an avian patient tends to bleed slightly more. Or if the patient's ASS score is more than 2. Tranexamic acid has significantly helped us in reducing the bleeding intra-op, and we tend to give one dose 15 minutes before the incision time. What it have, it actually stabilizes the clot. So whatever the bleeding points are there, where the body naturally blocks them by clot, it prevents the breakdown of that clot. So it has no change in any of the thromboembolic complications, and rather the requirement of transfusion has been significantly reduced, and we have seen that in the last more than 12-13 years. Now coming second to the nerve injury, which is, I put in the black background because this is one of the most disastrous complication of a hip replacement, because if the sciatic nerve is gone, the complete limb is useless. Whatever you do to the hip, that limb will become flail, and we don't have any treatment for this. So Thankfully, the incidence is less. It's just 0.05 to 1.9%. What are the risk factors? If it's a revision surgery, you need to very, very carefully need to isolate the nerve. If the patient is of female sex, because of the heavy gluteal muscles or the fat pad, sometimes it's the newer surgeons can't reach to that level, can't feel the nerve and they say it's there. DDH is a very high possibility of a nerve injury because the acetabulum is quite shallow and the nerve travels very close to the posterior wall of the acetabulum. So if you are not very careful in the surgery, you can damage, or if you have over lengthened the limb, especially if in a crow type 4 or 3, if you are not careful in doing the subtrochanteric osteotomy, the patient in the posterior period may end up with a sciatic nerve injury. If you are doing a cemented hip, the pressure, the cement or the thermal injury can also occur. Or in the posterior period, if there is a significant hematoma, then these causes you need to identify very, very quickly because they can lead to a problem later on. So why there is a sciatic nerve injury? Because you see, it runs very close to the hip joint, the posterior wall, and also on the superior wall. So you need to be very, very careful when you are operating on the hip, and especially for the sciatic nerve injury. Femoral nerve injury also can occur, but that is usually in dysplastic hip when you're putting an anterior retractor, if you're a posterior hip surgeon. So this is one of the revision cases where we have to isolate the nerve through and through and put these vessel loops so that you don't damage the nerve any time during your surgery. So how to manage? Once you have got the injury now, how do you manage these? So I've discussed these kind of cases where the crow type 4, you need to bring the hip down to the level and then you need to do a subtrochanteric osteotomy so that you don't overstretch the soft tissues. Otherwise, if you try to bring the hip to this level, the sciatic nerve is bound to get damaged, right? So first thing, if you see a sciatic nerve injury post-op period, you first ensure that you get all the radiological investigation which are possible in your center. So ultrasound or an MRI. MRI is much better if you have the facility to rule out any kind of pressure on the sciatic nerve. And you could even do the neurography to see the nerve right through the course. You can do the nerve conduction study just to see at what level the injury is so that you can make out whether your surgery is a problem or some other spine issue has crept up because of the surgery. If the limb is lengthened significantly and you cannot find any other cause, then you have to go in and reduce the size of the taper, reduce the size of the head so that you can release the nerve. And if the hematoma is there, obviously you need to remove the hematoma so that you can remove the pressure on the nerve. Now, this is one very beautiful thing I found in this journal. There's a post-op MRI has been done for this patient. And if you see the peroneal part of the sciatic nerve has been pressed underneath the circular as well, which has been put around the proximal femur for a crack in the femur while putting a cementless hip. So these kind of things which you can find out. So if you find this, you have to go in quickly and release the nerve. That is the only saving you have. Otherwise, the moment it is gone, this nerve will never recover. So most cases, unknown etiology, probably because the surgeon doesn't want to say that this is because of his fault. So they go unnoticed and say, there's no reason for the sciatic nerve injury. I had done everything right. But if you investigate, like I've shown you in the MRI, then you have to do the treatment. Otherwise, if there's no reason, just go for the conservative management. Keep a close follow-up. That patient will trouble you a lot throughout the next course until unless he recovers fully or he leaves you. Now coming to these, some intra-op periprosthetic fractures. So we are primarily focusing on the intra-op complications and some of the post-op complications. So post-op periprosthetic fractures is a big topic altogether. So I'll focus on the intra-op periprosthetic fractures. This has been found more frequently with the cementless process because you need to have a good scratch fit, right? And that's what Dr. He also discussed, that you have to have a good fit, primary fit. And to achieve that, sometimes the experienced surgeon comes that you have to have that balance that yes, this is the right amount of the size, and if I go beyond this, probably I will fracture it. Why the incidence is increasing? Because of the increasing life expectancy leading to more aging population. More aging population, poor bone quality, and increased risk of fall. That leads to post-operative fractures. But intra-op, because of poor bone quality and because of our training, if I see many surgeons are very well versed with the cemented hips. They're more convenient with the cementless hip because it's a time saving and you don't have to fiddle with the cement. So if you put a cementless hip in a poor bone quality and you're not that experienced, you're going to cause the fracture. Simultaneously, because of more younger population we are operating, because many of the younger patients they are coming up for the surgery, we tend to have high risk of fractures. So sometimes you have to have the femur is curved and you want to go in with a straight reamer, which is provided with the hip replacement set. So you should have your trauma set along with you, and I tend to ream these femurs, especially for revisions, on a guided wire like we do for the interlocking nails. So this is what I say. If you see there is a crack on the trochanter after the cementless hip has been done. Or if you can see here, there's a post-op CT taken from the same journal. So I've been saying that you have a crack which is through and through. And now after the surgery, you can't do too much for this patient. You just have to delay the weight bearing for this patient and hope for the best that this fracture should heal, because nothing as such has been changed. The periosteum is intact, but you can't start weight bearing straight away. So when to doubt these things, if in the post-op period, if you're mobilizing the patient say that I have a pain somewhere in the thigh, that means there is some problem in the thigh bone. So again, another patient where there's a crack in the thigh bone, the femur bone, these you can primarily diagnose on the CT scan only. X-rays are absolutely normal, right? Another patient where we had done the cerclage, if you see there's a crack, so this you have found intraop and then you cerclage, so you know how much good compression you are given on the cerclage and you can start the weight bearing. Now this is one video which I want to show, so when to stop. So when you're doing a broach, that's the commonest time when you get the fracture. So if you can hear the sound will change. So now the pitch has changed. The pitch of the fineness of that sound has changed. So you have to stop at this level and don't hammer so that you want to put the full broach in. You have to come out again and go gradually. Or if you're not going in, then you have to use a straight reamer so that, maybe the isthmus part is not allowing the broach to go in. So that's very, very careful. Don't hammer at this point of time with a strong hand. Otherwise, you will see a crack in the femur bone. This you can find out sometimes that if you're not done a proper job, you miss the fracture. After a few days, the patient come with the completely displaced prosthesis. This is only intra because proximally there is no fracture. The calcar fracture was missed and you can see the fracture in the post-op X-ray. Now, something which is the experience shows that sometimes it happens that you feel that this is a good scratch fit and you already have faced some problems. This is my own case. So we did this revision case for the old cemented hip. And during the surgery, there was a break in the cortex because while removing the cement, one of the drill was going in the cortex. So we used the C-arm and then we could reach to the right level in the center. Now, it looked good on the feel and on the C-arm image as well. So that's reasonably done case. But after a few days, this stem subsided in. So obviously the experience will teach you a few more things, but yes, that experience will come down here. So this is my own case, but we had to revise this because you need a slightly bigger stem so that I have a good scratch fit. And because of the fracture, we were more worried in this case that if we go slightly more probably, we may do a splinter in the femur. But these are all part of the game, so you have to accept these. So then coming to intraop acetabulum fractures. So acetabulum fractures are usually not very common because you can't see them first. And if you are hammering on the acetabulum cup and suddenly you see that the sound has changed, that means you have cracked the acetabulum. That's the practical tip. But if you get a fracture, which is just like a hairline fracture, as you can see here, and you just delay the weight bearing of this patient and probably he will heal with time. But if it is too much like this, then probably this cup will go inside the pelvis very soon, within few days. Another patient where the fracture was missed during the surgery and the cup has moved inside. Now, this is very interesting paper, the case report I found in the literature, where this patient had a fracture, the posterior column fracture, and they rather repaired the posterior wall and column and used the same cup, and that's the follow-up of this patient. So this also, you have to, if you find this intra-op, then you have to do a fixation, like the acetabulum fixation, if you're, and then fix the cup as we are doing. So this is what happened to that patient, that moved, the cup moved in, and you have to straight away go for these because there's a pelvic discontinuity, and we have to use a cage and the new hip. Now, dislocation is also one of the nightmare for the surgeon. If your patient comes in the ER and your resident says, sir, we did the hip few days back or months back, and that patient has come back with a dislocated hip. So it's usually a surgeon's failure. So there's no denial in that, that the surgeon has failed there. And the incidence is, an experienced surgeon, very less, newer surgeons on a higher side. And almost most of them will dislocate in the first year of operation. And one third will keep on having the dislocations. And the risk factors are multiple. Can be patient-related, surgeon-related, or implant-related. So implants are never failed. So it's a surgeon who fails in next two categories. So the patients, if they are having cerebral palsy, muscular dystrophy, dementia, I would probably refrain from offering them a joint replacement surgery, even Parkinson's patients. If the patient is not compliant, alcoholic, not able to, not, don't want to listen to you. If the patient is not following the hip precautions, then also they can have the fracture. Or even the old hip surgery, that can also lead to a poor or high risk of the dislocation. Surgery related, if you're a posterior approach surgeon, the literature says it's on the higher side, but I would say that it's primarily the implant position which leads to the dislocation rather than the approach. You need to have good soft tissue tension, and proper implant design and orientation is important. Surgeon experience in the implant alignment is very, very important for the stability. So I'll show you a small video how I check the stability. So we do a primarily a shock test, which should be having 3 to 5 millimeter of the opening. Then you check the full flexion, adduction, and then the internal rotation. And then you go for the abduction and external rotation and extension. So you see, this is the type of stability the hip should have before you are closing your hip. Or I do trial always before putting the final implant. Now, certain dislocations can happen because of the implant, but I would entirely disagree with this, because you as a surgeon have to choose the right kind of implant, but never, never use an implant with the head with a skirt, because that will reduce your jump distance. But try to avoid, until it's a revision surgery, multiple revisions, where you have to use it. Otherwise, we can avoid using the skirted in the primary hips. And if you still feel that your hip is dislocating, then you can move to the larger head so that the jump distance will also improve. Now, this patient, where he had a acetabulum fracture, SI joint disruption, which is badly managed and with infection. And he came to us almost 3-4 months after this injury, and this was done somewhere else. So we did a surgery, we did the hip replacement, and we didn't do anything to the SI joint. And during surgery, we thought that probably the abductors are of good strength and good tension. But 20th day after surgery, the patient came back with, in the emergency, with a dislocated hip. We did a CT as well to see that all implant orientation is fine. Unfortunately, because of the pandemic, I'm not able to access the PACS. So we reduced this in the ER, quite easy reduction. 2 days again, he came back with the dislocation. This time we gave him because we knew that the implant orientation is fine, so we gave him an abduction brace. So he came back after 3 months, and this hip is still located. 7 months, he seems to be doing well after the abduction brace. We also did the spinopelvic X-ray to see that there is no malpositioning or some spine scoliosis which could lead to the frequent dislocations. So he has some short limb gait, some abductor lurch is there because of the weak abductors, which we thought that they should be fine. I don't want to put a constrained liner in this patient because he's so young. He's just 28 years of age. So initially, all dislocation are managed by the closed reduction. And you put the patient abduction brace. And patient with recurrent dislocation, you can offer them either a bipolar hemiarthroplasty because of the big, large head size or a dual mobility cup. Now, limb length discrepancy is one thing which is very, very problematic for the patient. As you can see here in this patient, the limb has been lengthened and the implant has not gone fully in. So the most common cause of dissatisfaction, almost 16-32%. The shortening is perceived as more than 10 millimeter, but lengthening is perceived even if it is 6 millimeter. It can lead to back pain, gait disorder, dislocations. And it is mostly because of femoral component problem. And there's one study in 2005 which says that out of 90 unilateral THR, 74 were lengthened. So offset is one thing which you have to be very, very careful while putting the hip. And we aim for usually not less than the normal offset for that particular patient. The surgeon has a problem whether he should choose the stability or limb length, because on table, you see that the hip looks unstable. But if you are very, very clear in your measurements of the offset, the hip should be reduced during surgery easily. It should not be a struggle to reduce the hip. If you're struggling, that means you are lengthening the hip any day. So if you reduce the offset, that can lead to abductor lurch. The joint reaction force will increase energy consumption for the patient. Like you see, the last patient was moving with the lurch, can lead to impingement and dislocation. If you increase the offset, that will lead to decrease the joint reaction force, but the abductors will be tightened and there will be increased torque force between the cement and the stem if you're using a cemented stem. So if in a surgical situation, you see that your hip is dislocating while trialing, so you need to increase the offset, but you don't increase the length. So you can decrease the neck shaft angle from 132 to 127 or 125, increase the head neck length. You can medialize the femoral neck. You can also advance the GT like the great Sir Chanley used to do it. Or some acetabular component have a oblong poly, which can lead to more poly in the bottom of the cup. We can use a lot of these devices. So basically all of them use one fixed point on the pelvis, and you can take one point on the trochanter and then measure before and after the surgery. There are different devices available. The mode of them is same. The Chanley's shock test is very, very subjective. Dropkick test will work only when it is too tight. Leg-to-leg test has a problem because the lower limb is abducted and the upper limb, when you touch on that, is the adducted. So you can't measure the exact length. If you do the gross measurement of touching the knee and the foot, you're probably lengthening your leg. On-table radiographs are probably the best one, but it's very, very difficult and you have the problem of breaching the sterility for that surgical field. Wire caliper, Steenman pain, something you have to use, you have to take a one fixed point on the pelvis. Like you see, you can do the marking and you measure them, but they see this is abducted and this is adducted. So best is the one fixed point on the pelvis and the other point on the shaft of the femur, so that you can measure them together. And then before and after surgery, you can see that what is the best for this patient. You can also take the point in the infracotyloid fossa and mark the Steenman pin point on the trochanter and then measure after the trial implants. You can also take one point on the femur rather than on the pelvis. So I take one point on the GT or LT and measure the vertical and horizontal offset and replicate the same after the surgery to have a better result. There's a gross one. You can check on the X-ray of the pelvis to see that the other hip is having the center of the femoral head at tip of trochanter, just below or above, and replicate the same. Try to replicate the same during surgery. So this is a very interesting finding in 2008. Out of 1,114 patients, only 6% get the equal leg length. So you see how much a surgeon makes an error on a limb lengthening side. So certain non-surgical methods, you can give a shoe raise, you can shave the other side, sole, physiotherapy if there is a spinal contracture, just to balance out the muscles. Surgical options are very, very limited because all the methods have failed, then only you can go for, suppose there's a foot drop, then you have to definitely go in, change the femoral component to a higher offset, use the large head trochanteric advancement as Chanlay did, or a constrained cup, or a dual femoral osteotomy for shortening is a very, very extreme step to do. Now, the last complication is the infection is one very big complication, and every operation is an surgery, is an experiment in the bacteriology. And you see, this statement was given 1880, almost 1.5 decade from now. And even true it is. But with the advent of the prophylactic antibiotics, the incidence has gone down significantly. But don't use beyond 48 hours. Thankfully, the incidence is very low because of the current scenario. So there are four different types of infection which we find out. One is the intraop finding. We see that there is an intraop. Either you have a doubt or you see a frank pus, there's an intraop. So you have to abandon the surgery if you see frank pus. Or if you had a doubtful tissue and you were dare enough to go ahead with the surgery and you found that two of the cultures are positive, then you have to give antibiotics. You treat it as a one-stage infected revision case and give the antibiotics for 6 weeks, follow with the ESR, CRP, and hope for the best. Early post-op infection, you need to be very, very aggressive. Within first month, go in, debride, and try to salvage the process. Treat as an acute infection, go in, do everything. Same is the type 3, which happens not in the first month, but it can happen anytime throughout the life of the patient. Like the septic arthritis, which can happen to anyone. It's a hematogenous infection. Somewhere else, the body is harboring a focus, and from there, the infection comes to the joint. And then you have to try to salvage if the implant is well fixed. And if it's a chronic infection, then you have to remove the processes and do a one stage or two stage, depending on a lot of parameters. Now, what leads to increase in the risk factors? So any prior surgery, patient with inflammatory arthritis, steroid-dependent patients, immunocompromised patients, malnourished renal patients, patients with skin disorder or diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes, all can lead to increased risk of infection. Patient can present with the pain, fever, restricted movement, sudden onset. And you need to be very careful. Seeing picture like this, it's a definite infection, nothing else. So that's one patient where two surgeries already done, infected hip. We had to revise this. Now, one thing is that the ESR and CRP are a very good screening tool with a very high sensitivity. They're rarely normal in the face of infection. If you see in your post-op period, ESR, CRP raised along with the clinical suspicion, don't think of anything else. You have to accept, inform the patient, and go ahead and do a thorough wash. Excess will show the changes later on. That's for the chronic infections. Aspiration of joint is important. And what the criteria we follow is that if there is an increasing ESR, CRP, WBC count is more than 3,000, and out of this, more than 60% PMN, it's definitely infection. There's a gray zone in between where you can repeat the aspiration or do other tests. According to WHO's guideline, if there are any one of them, there's a draining sinus or two positive cells, a definite infection, or any of the four minor criteria. So what we follow is you feel infected, get an ESR, CRP, they are normal, no infection. If they're elevated, aspirate, culture positive, infected, in between, or on a higher side, clinical suspicion is there, we consider as an infected hip. The goal is to eradicate the infection, elevate the pain, and maintain the functionality of the limb. And there are not many options by the resection arthroplasty, that's girdle stone. Reimplantation is preferred by the patient. Either two stage or one stage, entirely your guts and experience. Arthrodesis or last is an amputation. Few examples. That's in spacer. We did a constrained hip. That's the case which I showed in the beginning. We put a spacer in, then did a revision in the second stage. Another patient, this also seen the X-ray before. You see the pelvic discontinuity. And with a cage construct. Now, few rare complications, heterotopic bone formation, which happens the range from 0.6 to 90%. The risk factors you need to be very, very, you need to learn them. Male gender, previous history of heterotopic ossification, pre-existing hip fusion, Angst bond, Paget's disease, post-traumatic osteoarthritis, AVN, and rheumatoid arthritis. What do you need to do? You need to give them proper medication. So we give them the NSAID, the radiotherapy if you have the facility, And physiotherapy during the maturation phase so that they can help in resolving the ossification. You see, extracorporeal shockwave, I have no experience. I have no experience with the embolization of nutrient arteries which can prevent the further ossification. But yes, we have to excise the surgical lesions many times. Osteolysis, aseptic loosening is a long-term. Trochanteric bursitis can happen if you have increased the offset, horizontal offset, and can that lead to the abductor tightness and can lead to trochanteric bursitis. And Dr. Gahir already discussed the squeaking part, which happens if your cup is not properly oriented. So in my practice, I primarily use the ceramic on poly rather than ceramic on ceramic prosthesis. I thank you all for patient hearing and a virtual handshake for all of you. If you have any questions, we can go ahead now. I'll stop sharing my screen.
Yes, thank you, doctor. Thank you for that very elaborate session. And I know it's a very vast topic. So thank you.
That's a vast topic.
That's all through that. Yes, so I request the attendees, if you have any questions or discussion points, please put them in the Q&A tab. I think as of now, we don't have.
So I have got some questions from Ortho TV viewers. Hi,
Rajendra.
Yes, okay. Yeah. Hi, Neeraj.
So Dr. Rajender Singh Gahir and we go a long way back, I think 10 years back, we did one course together. Yes. And then he attended my technical technology course in Bombay, yes. JJ Hospital, as far as I remember.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'll start with him. So the question for him is that in today's day and age, what I had heard in Europe, especially as you're working in UK, which is now, I think, different from Europe. So was that ceramic on ceramic was the choice of implant. Mm-hmm. But according to your presentation, now it has gone towards ceramic on poly, which is giving almost the same result.
Yes.
Yeah. So my understanding is right. So why this change has happened recently? What has changed in the last 10 years or 15 years, which has now ceramic to ceramic and then ceramic to poly? Is the complication rate high or the poly is working better?
See, traditionally, we've been using poly for, we've got sort of follow-ups of more than 30 years for the first generation poly. Forget about the ultra-high molecular weights. Some of Chandler's hips have survived 35 years. Now, we know poly works very well. Now, with the advent of ceramic, we started with ceramic on poly, worked well. And then we came with ceramic on ceramic. So with ceramic on ceramic came up these issues of, patients being aware of the squeaking in the hip, which generally used to go away after a certain point of time. Once it sort of homes in, it settles in, that would go away. But then what was found that as we started doing total hips in younger and younger patients, their level of activities was very high. In Europe, we had lots of patients who had skiing accidents. So they would land while skiing down the slope, they would land. And there were incidences where the ceramic head and the ceramic, the liner both have broken. So there were fractures of ceramic, either the liner or the head. So it's a comparison. You're getting good results with poly. And you're facing this new sort of complication with ceramic on ceramic. So I think we've sort of gradually drifted back to ceramic. And also the cost was an issue with using ceramic on either side. So with one side being poly, the cost has come down as well.
Okay. So that also actually from NHS point of view, that maybe makes a very big difference. In India, the patient bears all the cost. So now there is one, has we reached a clarity in this way, ke the metal on poly versus ceramic on poly. So in younger patient, we should do ceramic on poly. Because the cost factor even in India is not much, only 25,000, I think, Dr. Subhash?
Yes, 15 now, yeah.
15,000.
Yeah.
So that is now very clear. So what is the age where you will start doing metal on poly and you will leave the ceramic on poly? Is there a certain age or you will still do it at the age of 75 also?
See, if my patient is sort of physiologically young, has got good bone stock and the patient's muscle bulk is good, the patient leads a very active lifestyle, then I would give a ceramic head.
Hmm. Okay.
No, I wouldn't use an age like a 65. We all when we used to read the books about doing an Austin Moore and doing a fixation of the hips, it's not the number. It's the level of activity and how the patient sort of presents to you. So if the expectation of my patient, he wants to get back to cycling, get back to most activity, I would give a ceramic head.
Okay. Only in a sedentary lifestyle patient, you would go for a metallic.
Yes.
Metal on poly.
Yes.
That is very later on in life. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now we come to the stems. The second question is about the stems. So I have been attending a lot of webinars because we are doing the Ortho TV program on arthroplasty. So there is one speaker from, but what one? The porous coated one, the HA coated one, or both are the same results? Like for example, Zimmer versus Correll.
Yeah. I would prefer a coil for that.
Okay. Okay. For a younger patient, you would prefer a coil.
Yes. Yeah.
And when would you start using a cemented hip? So, or maybe I can ask you, in the last year, how many cemented hips have you done?
Less than 20%.
Less than 20%.
Okay. And you know, even if I have got a young patient, I'm planning to do an uncemented, I always have a backup of cement, of a cemented hip. You know, if I see the bone quality is not good and my rasp just goes in very easily, I would cement it.
Okay.
And it is actually, it's not the stem cement or the uncemented. It's the training part is one part. And the other thing is that I spoke in my talk that implant never fails. So cemented stems have done really well. Uncemented stems have also done very well. You need to put them really well. Mm-hmm. Whether you do cemented or uncemented, doesn't matter. But on the acetabulum side, definitely the cementless has an advantage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But on the femoral side, if you do good job, no border you can see between the cortex and the stem with a complete white cementing, it's absolutely wonderful to see that. But obviously, not every patient can have the similar kind of results. And then there's a problem starts. So if I can do a good cementless stem, which can last for a similar kind of time, then I would prefer a cementless stem. Maybe the training is lacking, but as Dr. Gahir has worked in Exeter, he's been trained there, but even he thinks that it's not been, he cannot replicate the same technique in his practice, then there's a problem. And Exeter is a philosophy.
Yeah.
So they would like to put cement everywhere.
Right.
So you can't be blind to one thing that I will do only this way. We do both ways depending on the scenario. So we change our protocols.
Okay. So now I'll come to you. So Dr. Subhash, tell me one thing to revise, because you have talked about complications. You have seen more complications with uncemented or cemented. So I'm not talking about, maybe you can say infections. I can say infections. Have you seen more infection than cemented or uncemented? Is it like that or it's not like that?
Infection has no relation with the cement or uncement.
Okay.
So maximum complications has occurred because of the malpositioning of the component.
Okay.
And second one is the infection. Cement or not cemented will not matter much until it's a badly done cementing or a badly put uncemented component. So I'll put it that way. Rather than saying the implant is cemented or uncemented is problem, no. Is the badly done cementing, badly done uncemented will fail. So it's primarily the implant malpositioning which has caused the problem rather than the implant per se.
Okay. So we have one question from one of our audience. Is there, Dr. Sharik is asking, is there any avoidance of cross-leg sitting post-operative?
So I don't allow the patient to do cross-sitting. So there is a hip which has come, dual mobility hip, which say that the mobility will be very good and you can do the cross-leg sitting. Now, my philosophy is different. So life is all about moving around. Life is not about sitting around, right? So sitting is not that important. You are sitting right now also. There's no problem in the hip. Now, I can give you a range which will be good for routine activities. But what would you like to achieve by sitting cross-legged or squatting? Dual mobility was originally designed for elderly patients in a fractured neck or femur to avoid the dislocation part, right? For there we do bipolars, then they came the tripolar, there's a dual mobility cup. Now, if you want to do the same thing in a younger patient, we may be burning our fingers like we burnt with the metal-on-metal MOM, the J&J ASR.
ASR, right.
Right. So same thing can happen with these dual mobility as well. It's very early to comment that a young patients can, because the more bearing you add more chances of wear.
Right.
Why Chanle worked very well? Because it has only single stem and a cup. There was no bearing in between. The Zimmer ML taper failed because they gave you a lot of options. Mm-hmm. You put a stem, then you put a neck separately, then you put a head, then there is a liner, then there's a shell.
Lots of trunnion failure.
It went away. So I'm very, very careful in adding any more modularity to my implant. So I don't tell them that you will get 20% extra range. I would say you'll get 10 years extra years of life of your hip rather than 20 degree extra range by taking dual mobility. I may be sounding odd in this because dual mobility is currently going up, but I'm always very, very careful when something goes like this.
Okay. It
falls also like this.
So in your practice, Dr. Subhash, where you're showing about complications, So earlier days, like around 10-12 years back, when I used to discuss with the senior arthroplasty surgeons in Mumbai who are doing mainly hips, like Dr. Harish Bende, he used to say, and Dr. Lard, he used to say that the most common complication of a most common reason for a revision in their practice was infection. In India, at least, that is what they were saying. So what about you? What is the most common reason for a revision in your practice today? Is it infection or malposition?
Still the infection.
Still the infection.
Because what happens is that in the... it's like people will feel bad about this, but plenty of surgeons still feel that giving antibiotics is a treatment for infection or prophylaxis. Yes. You need to have a proper surgical technique, good draping technique, and good soft tissue handling. Then they come to you. So antibiotic is not a solution. The first presentation in my PG was on prevention of infection. And if in India, the surgeon thinks that I can give high dose antibiotic and whatever the OT scenario is, whatever the OT traffic is, whatever drapes you're using, it doesn't matter. How do you scrub doesn't matter. So those things are more important rather than antibiotic.
You are perfectly right. That is basically what has been taught to us by Dr. Agashe in Mumbai here. He always talks about this, that antibiotic is not the solution. If you not have suspect infection, just open, give a wash, and then you'll still be able to salvage the implant.
Much better.
Yes.
Much better.
Yeah. You take the patient in, reopen, just give a wash. Even if there is no infection, it's all right, but you'll still be able to salvage. And I have been able to salvage at least in trauma 2-3 times.
No, plenty of times. You will even salvage joints.
Yes.
Because on the day, suppose 10 or 14, if you see there's some redness, some ooze, open up, wash. What happens? Have you seen, read the technique of the flap, the plastic surgery they do? They open, they release, they put some spacer inside, and then they do the flap. So the healing becomes much better. Second insult, after 2 weeks or 3 weeks, makes the healing much better. These patients, that technique works really well.
So now what has happened in the last few years that I have observed, at least in my practice, there were two cases. After that, I stopped doing that company's implant. So there were two cases where I did an uncemented THR of an Indian company, okay, which was a replica of either Corel or something like that. And both of them got infected. And basically, both the times the patient was a little bit immunocompromised, both were diabetics and everything. But I still feel that in spite of taking all the care and doing it in different OTs, both of them got infected. And one of my friends who assists me, he said that his also two cases got infected. So I feel that the Indian uncemented implants are still not ready for the market. Have you seen that?
I would seen not a trend towards infection, but I've seen a trend towards more complications. I don't do any Indian implant as such. But the reason being because I am not very, very satisfied with the quality of the sterilization and the quality of the plasma spray coating or whatever coating they say we have done it. So I'm probably not very comfortable. But yes, sometimes we have to do them because of the cost constraints and especially for the implants where I have to use the limb salvage surgery for, because I do a lot of onco surgery as well. So for there, I have to use because the international implants are quite costly. So for there I use, but for the otherwise routine primary hips, because maybe I'm working in a corporate sector where these kind of patients don't turn up to me who can't afford a hospital like this. So they ask for each and everything, which implant you're going to use, what is the long-term result of that. So, and we give them the proper boxes and the sticker certificate as well. So I don't see those patients, but yes, we have seen the complications with these implants. Sometimes the poly breakage, sometimes the trunnion breakage. I have one case where the implant is broken from the neck.
Okay. So thank you very much. So I think this is the time we have for today. Over to you, Grace. Thank you, Rajinder. It was nice seeing you after.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you, Neera. You're doing a great work with Dr. Jesus.
Thank you for being discussed. Yes, thank you so much for that very interesting discussion. Thank you.
Yeah, the Dr. Neera has made the discussion quite interesting.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay, dear. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.